Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on a Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words,
as a reminder, please fill in all available seats. If you see a seat next to you, fill it in so we can accommodate as many people as possible.
Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you. Song, let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true.
Hey, good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Jeff Kane, the director of the university's honors program, and through our honors series, we're pleased to bring you this special event tonight, especially in conjunction with Blue and Gold Week. A few thank yous, first of all, I'd like to thank the student union events staff for helping out with this a lot, the Touch and Go committee, or the Touch and Go personnel for setting up all of this. Done a great job, IT events as well, and student engagement office. So quite a few people have helped to get this off the ground. Our guest tonight is Mr. Fred Hayes, who began his 20-year NASA career as an aeronautical research pilot, serving as backup crew for the Apollo 8, 11, and 16 missions, and as commander of the Space Shuttle Enterprise in 1977 for the approach and landing program at Edwards Air Force Base. But he is most well known as a crew member on the ill-fated Apollo 13 lunar mission in 1970. Mission control. Portrayed by actor Bill Paxton in the Apollo 13 movie, Hayes was the lunar module pilot on the actual space mission. In 1973, while flying an aircraft used in the filming of the Pearl Harbor movie, Tora, 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 Hayes was involved in an accident with a BT-13 aircraft that had been modified for the film. A fire erupted and Hayes was burned over 65% of his body. It would take 14 months of recovery and rehabilitation before he could return to the skies to subsequently command the Space Shuttle Enterprise in the 1977 approach and landing tests. Hayes served as president of Northrop Grumman Technical Services and has been awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom and the NASA Distinguished Service Medal, among others. He's also been inducted into the Astronaut Hall of Fame. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming a true American hero, Mr. Fred Hayes.
I'm going to have to stand because I got to see the video.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm happy to join you tonight. It's really amazing to see so many faces. With the COVID, I've only had one other event in 2 years that had been Zoom or Skype or something else hook up to have an assemblage of people like this. It's incredible. I'm glad to have a live, real-time audience here tonight. Thank you for coming. I got to this thing we're going to talk about a lot tonight, Apollo 13. Through a kind of a devious route, I went to school through junior college with a major of at that time of journalism, which I don't think people here would think too much of. But at any rate, I was budding to be a journalist, and the Korean War had come along. And at that time, and I was wanted to serve my country. And the only program I could get into at the age I was at, 18, with 2 years of college, was the Naval Aviation Cadet Program. The Air Force required you to be 19 at the time. And my dad had always encouraged me, if I was going to go in the military, to become an officer. So I signed up, as some often you do at 18, you hadn't necessarily thought too far ahead. And because I had never, ever been in an airplane, even on the ground, and was never particularly interested in airplanes. But it was one of those things from the first flight I had with a fellow named Hank Chenaud, Navy lieutenant, it was like magical. Being up in the sky there, even though I didn't go very high at that time. And I just knew right then that somehow I wasn't quite sure what kind of career it was going to be, but it was going to be in aviation. What I'm talking about is about 1953. So as yet, there obviously was no space program. There was no NASA. It was NACA at that time. So I joined the service. I spent during that four-year tour, I was in two different Marine squadrons, both fighter squadrons, and decided along that way, talking to mainly my commanding officer and ops officer, thinking about being a test pilot, and just reading a little bit, it was clear I was going to have to get an engineering degree with one of the prerequisites. So that's what I did. I went back to school and got an aeronautical engineering degree and decided to join NACA. At the time I was applying initially, it was NACA. And during that time, before I got accepted for an opening at Lewis Research Center in Cleveland, now named Glenn, after John Glenn, it became NASA, and the space program had evolved at that time with the selection of the first seven astronauts. Now, at the time, I didn't know, and many didn't know, if that was going to be a one-time program. They were going to fly mainly the mission to see how humans would do in space. And maybe that'd be all there was. It'd be Mercury, these people would fly, and that'd be it. But shortly after that, it became a lot bigger with the pronouncement of we're going back to the moon by the end of the decade. And, of course, that sprung Gemini program and subsequently the Apollo program to actually execute the lunar missions. So I decided eventually, even though I was having a lot of flying tests and airplanes, first at Lewis, and after 3.5 years, I moved to Edwards Air Force Base at NASA's Flight Research Center, now named Armstrong after Neil, to do flight testing there. Unfortunately, I wasn't like Neil. I didn't get to fly the X-15, but I did enjoy the flying I was doing there. But eventually decided I would apply for the astronaut program because the thought of getting a chance to go to the moon was just too much to pass up. And so I went to apply and was picked in 1966 to join the astronaut program, actually joined the astronaut office, which if I can figure out how to run this thing, I got to find the right button to get the, here we go, and that's the button. Get it over here to start the video. Anyway, I joined at Johnson Space Center then, which is Manned Spacecraft Center. And okay, I'm gonna need some help. Ah, okay. I was looking for that start button. There we go. All right, so now I'm gonna show you this video. It covers Apollo 13. I'll comment about that. This mission was really the third landing mission on the moon. The only difference was we were gonna land in a hilly area, the Farmoral Hills, which were south of the Imbrium Basin. The theorem being that when the meteor hit and formed the big left eye of the face in the moon, which is the Imbrium Basin, it spliced out material that formed those hills at Farmoral, and by collecting there, you were sampling material that came out of that hole, if you will, that initially was formed with the Imbrium Basin. Here we are, fully suited up. We got up that morning, checked out in our suits, and now headed out carrying these canisters supplying us oxygen to denitrogenate our bodies of nitrogen before liftoff by several hours. Same thing they do have done today, like on space station, they go into the airlock and denitrogenate before they go out for EVAs. And climbed aboard that fancy painted vehicle, which was really a converted milk truck NASA had at the time. We had intercom. We could talk to the suit techs on the way out. And up above the pad 39, in our case 39A, we're climbing aboard through the hatches into the command module, three of us, which is pretty crowded, particularly when you're in those bulky spacesuits. My position was in the right couch position. And so basically, as a lunar module pilot, I had to basically be familiar with the switches and things I could reach, because on launch, you're not going to move much out of that couch. This is mission control now at Houston. That was the firing room. And when this thing clears the tower, it switches to mission control for turnover. It's one of several firing rooms they had at Kennedy Space Center at the time. The liftoff, you can see, is very slow after the hold-down arms release. Even though there's a lot of push, the five engines generate 7.5 million pounds of thrust, but the vehicle weighs over 6 million pounds. But it's slowly the G's build up as you're going up because it's burning tons of liquid oxygen, and in that case, kerosene, RP-1, from those engines at the time. So it's getting lighter all the way as you're going up. The G levels hit about 4.5 G max. Actually, we shut off the center engine a little early so we wouldn't exceed that G level. And the fighters I'd flown had pulled 7 Gs, combat maneuvering, so that wasn't that high. The main thing was when the engines gimbaled, the four outer engines, it was herky-jerky. With that much thrust, even when you try to move an increment of a degree, it's moving a lot of thrust around. And we got a lot of left-right motion. The couches actually weren't fastened on the sides. We had like they were slung by arms that had some accumulative power in case we landed on land. You could stroke the couches to make a landing. And they had some play that allowed that left-right motion very pronounced, unlike an airplane. This is the scene now. We went into Earth orbit at 100 miles, went around a couple of times. The third engine was reignited by people on the ground in mission control, and it accelerated us to escape velocity at roughly 25,000 miles an hour. And this scene now is when we have left Earth, headed out to the moon. That black circle right in the upper right of the scene is the upper hatch of the landing craft. It's still sitting in the slaw area of the booster. It had coverings around it. It's a pretty delicate vehicle, and it could not have survived launch loads. So it was undercover through launch. Then those panels were separated. Jack Swigert's flying the vehicle. He's moved out a couple of hundred feet, turned around, and he's gone back in to put a probe in that dark circle with latches. When they latch, we fire latches that lock the two spacecraft together. When we get so sure we got an airtight seal, we go in there, and actually we had to reset two of the latches that hadn't quite fully sealed. That is the third stage where the lunar module was sitting in that right-hand open area there. This mission, for the first time, they used venting to redirect its path and make it impact on the moon. And they did that for all the third stages thereafter, because on each landing mission, we placed a seismometer. So they could get, with the ringing of the seismometer, they could get some idea of the subsurface stratum in the moon, much like they do hunting for oil and gas. They'll do a similar thing here on Earth. Now, we had a good flight for about over 50-something minutes, a little over 50 minutes, and we suffered an oxygen tank explosion. And that, of course, we basically just threw our flight plan in the trash can and had to start over from there. And that was a terrible time of time constraint and really pressure more on people on the ground, because they very quickly from that figured out an alternate flight plan and figured out the open items, what had to go get worked. And those people, when I talked to them and I got back, some of them that got the lead on going to solve those and figure out the procedures and the workarounds we had to do, I think most of them got less sleep on the ground than I got in flight. The actual time of the explosion, though, was a supreme sick feeling in my stomach of loss of mission. I really thought immediately that we were not in danger because we had two oxygen tanks. And it was clear we lost one, but it was a very slow leak in the second one. So for a little while, at least, I thought, well, we just blown the mission. After all that work, training through two previous missions to go fly, now's my big chance, and I've lost the landing. So I was just kind of half sick to my stomach at that time. It then got, obviously, life-threatening. And we ultimately, Jack Swigert was left alone in the command module and had to shut down the mothership. The command module, which had never intended ever to be shut down in flight. It got very cold because we to preserve power in the lunar module, which is made primarily for a two-day mission, landing on the moon and two EVAs, we now had to make it last 4 days. So we had to stretch the battery. We had four decent batteries in the decent stage and two in the ascent stage, and we now had the power severely down to make them last, and as a result, there was a thermal imbalance. We didn't have enough thermal blankets to be at that power level. We went down to about 12 amps, 12 amps on a 30-volt system. So roughly, you're at two light bulbs at the end of the sofa at the third click. So that's how much power we were using during that time. So it got very cold, froze the water tanks in the mothership. They were found still frozen when it was recovered on the ship. It got very damp. The water separator couldn't function again at that temperature. And water collected. We could look in the limb. There was no inner walls. We couldn't afford to wait. And you could see through the netting material that kind of covered that area, and you could see water globules on every turn of plumbing or wiring and around the connectors, a glob of water shimmering and a little bit of vibration of the pumps running. Here I am looking out the window back at the Earth. Now, that's not a good picture because it doesn't show the colors. The Earth, you could actually see the blues of the major oceans. You could see some major cloud patterns. And you can see the brown of like a continent, the Earth. That's the tunnel that connected the two vehicles. That's Jack Schwager asleep in the back of the limb. And I'm sleeping on the job here over on the pilot side. I had my arm tucked in not to emulate Napoleon, but if you don't, your arms kind of go to a minimum energy position, and it end up doing this and maybe move it a little bit. It would keep me awake, so I always tucked them in. That's Gene Kranz. You saw smoking a cigarette. Gene doesn't smoke anymore. That's the exploded area. The upper part of that picture should look as shiny and smooth as that lower section. That's where one quarter of the spacecraft blew away when the oxygen tank exploded. We had food. We kind of gave up on the better food was the powdered freeze-dry stuff. Actually, if you carefully kneaded it with hot water, it was pretty good. But we lost the hot water source. That was only in the mothership. So we ate mostly out of what we call these wet packs. I think Jack had it spooning out probably a thick beef stew at about 45 degrees temperature. And Jim had the package of Frankfurters. I lived mostly in a snack. There was one locker. That was a snack locker, and I lived off of pretty much peanuts and little bitty bread cubes and little bitty cookie cubes. So that was, for 4 days, that was my diet pretty much. A real miracle, the vehicle, after that abuse for 4 days, the command module, came to life and took us through this entry, which turned out to be, as best the Apollo overall program report showed, for entry accuracy, we had shared for second place the most accurate splashdown of the program. Now, this was after we violated the specifications on probably every piece of electronics in the command module, and yet it came back to life and gave us that performance, and the entry was done all automated through the computer when it was brought to life. Our G level was below 6 G's a little bit, but all the other lunar missions were a little above 6 G's, which said we were still a little shallow as we came in. Retrieved and to be brought on board the Iwo Jima aircraft carrier. It actually had been on combat duty in Vietnam, and it was rerouted on its way back to San Diego to drop by and picked up some Navy SEAL divers. That were trained to safe the capsule and get us up and onto the ship and the helicopter. This flight only ended up in 6 days. If we flew it normally, it would have been 12 days. So we had like half a flight. Phil felt a little stiff-legged, as they told me I would, even for that short time, due to blood that settles in your lower extremities after you touch down. And you can see we kind of walked a little stiff there. This is Mission Control people now celebrating, as they should have, for what they pulled off to get us back home. And this, I think, was a phone conversation they had us tuned in to President Nixon at the time. The next day, they whisked us out in a helicopter to the Samoan Islands, where we met an Air Force C-141, and went to Hawaii, where we met President Nixon, who had picked up our wives in Houston on Air Force One and brought them out to Hawaii to meet us. After the flight, I actually left the astronaut office and went to the program office for space shuttle. Well, I should say I trained for one more mission, Apollo 16, and to back up John Young. And when that, I was thought at the time I would fly 19. At the time, you'd normally cycle three missions. And I had Jerry Carr and Bill Pogue, and we would have got to go back to the moon in 19, but they canceled 18 and 19. So I moved to the program office for the early development of shuttle, worked for Aaron Cohen in the orbiter project office, and for 4 years. And leading up to the approach and landing test of the very first orbiter we built, Enterprise, and I was fortunately named to be one of the crew. We had two crews, myself and Gardo Fullerton, and the other crew was Joe Engel and Dick Truly. So the two of us got to fly an 8-flight test program on Enterprise, where we launched off the top of a 747. And I got to fly 5 of the 8 flights. This is the launch morning of the very first free flight. We called FF1. And Gardo and I are climbing aboard the Enterprise in a special fixture they had built at NASA Flight Research Center, with a 747 set below, and we were placed on top. Taxiing out, it was even before when we got in the vehicle. It's kind of strange. From the orbiter, you can lean over, look out windows, whatever direction. You can't see the 747, so it's kind of like magic. It gets backed out. It's taxiing here. It always seemed to be taxiing slow, though, because you're so high up. In fact, we had to practice rappelling, because that was our manner of escape from on top there. We'd have to rappel down to the ground if, for whatever reason, the 747 caught fire or something. But it taxied out at Edwards to the main big runway, and here it is taking off. And I really thought Fitz had rotated early. Fitz Fulton was the primary pilot in the 747. Because again, it seemed so slow when he rotated to take off. We had an array of chase airplanes. Two of them were actually official photographers to shoot photos. And we had one chase that would give us clear when we come off the top vertically, and the other one looking from the side to say we cleared when I turned, that we were clear laterally. So that was the first time we separated from the 747, Free Flight 1. We were at about 25,000 feet at that time. From there on, you're a glider. That first flight was the longest flight of the program, 5 minutes, I think, in 21 seconds. So it was not a program to build up a lot of flight time. Now, that's not a contrail. That's just the vortex generation off the wings. Just for whatever reason, at that altitude, they had a lot of moisture. So the vortex coming off the wingtips generated at what looked like a contrail there, at what you'd see at high altitude. We did lose a computer right as we separated. The primary system had 4 computers working in unison, and then we had a 5th computer that was our backup computer and backup control system. And that computer failed. The other 3 computers voted it out. Gardo got big red X on the screen, and CRT, and Gardo Fullerton reached pull circuit breakers, the rate gyros, body accelerometers, the IMU, to make sure that computer and the computer power itself, that it wouldn't pollute the other computers. So he lost about 5 minutes of the first part of the flight. Here we are landing on the lake bed. We landed to the south. That lake bed is, can't hardly miss it. That runway is like 8 miles long, so it's a good place to do first flights, or a lot of airplanes that have had emergencies of various sorts will fly from across the country, like B-52s, they'll come land at Edwards to have that lake bed availability. And Gardo and I are now exiting Enterprise, coming out the lower hatch onto the lake bed where we had stopped. I could just leave it there, since I can't find the X. There's the X. All right, well, at any rate. You'll have to excuse me, even though I went to the moon. Here's my technology I'm using these days. I'm really not that bad. It's just that right here, this whole keyboard's in the dark, so I can't see anything. But at any rate, the approaching landing test finished, and I was planning to fly, hope to fly, and assigned for the third orbital flight with Jack Lousma. It was a very exciting mission. We were going to go up and rescue Skylab, which was the orbit was decaying, and it was going to fall in uncontrolled. And we were going to carry up a small kick stage in our payload bay, do a rendezvous. Jack was actually learning to fly this little kick stage with a swizzle stick and go dock with Skylab. And then people on the ground would properly orient it to deorbit it somewhere in the Pacific Ocean or boost it. But that mission went away because the schedule kept slipping on the shuttle launch dates. And Skylab fell in somewhat unceremoniously into Australia. Fortunately, most of it hit in the wilds of Australia that survived, pieces that survived. So no one was harmed by that entry. I decided at that time to, I was not interested in flying the mission that remained, which was going to be like a thermal test mission to go up and sit in various attitudes on orbit and collect thermal data. So I decided then to go to my next career, which I'd already planned from my 4 years in the Orbiter Project Office to go into management. And I joined the Grumman Corporation, which later became Northrop Grumman, and ended up running two subsidiary companies, one of each company ultimately after we merged. So I continued to have a fairly interesting, challenging career in the business world with a number of pretty interesting contracts for 12 years. I had a part of a contract with Northrop, with Lockheed Martin and Thiokol. We turned around shuttles at Kennedy Space Center for 12 years to turn around to get them ready to fly again. And then I was 4 years in Washington running the system engineering integration contract for Space Station Freedom, which later has been renamed ISS. Which was a very difficult time at that point in the program, the first 4 years. We were struggling every year to continue the program to get congressional funding. I call it my time in purgatory. But eventually the Russians joined the program, and that actually stabilized the funding when the Russians initially joined the program and eventually got past that phase B into what you call a heavier funding required to actually build it. And today it's still up there flying. So I've had a very interesting career over 17 years with Northrop Grumman, after 20 years with NASA and 4 years and 5 years in the military. So I can't complain where I am now at 88 years old. I've been lucky, very lucky to be at the right time, so to speak, with the right resume to fit into things that have been pretty great, kind of the tail end of the golden area of flight test at Edwards, and the, I call it to date at least, the golden age of space in the Apollo program. So I feel very, very lucky and fortunate to have enjoyed that for that many years. Anyway, at this point, maybe I turn it over if we can have a few questions. Anybody have any questions? I don't know, we can't answer. I don't know how many in here can't answer 500 questions, maybe a few. Hello, you hot mic?
Hello?
I hear you, loud and clear.
If given another chance to fly to the moon, would you take it?
Given another chance?
Yes.
Not unless I can find somebody with a time machine. At 88 years old, I'm just not physically able. It's not the flight as much as the training. The training is very wearing. It's long hours, many long hour days, over a long period of time. The flight is not as physically hard as the training is, frankly, at least for the missions we train for at Apollo. But no, I'd certainly love to have gotten back to try that second time to get on the moon on 19, to try to land and walk on the moon. That went by the wayside. Funding.
Hi, Mr. Fred Hayes. I'm Michael Batko. I'm a sophomore in aeronautical science. And with your experience on the Enterprise orbiter, I know on a lot of aircraft you have like the ailerons, flaps, stabilator, et cetera. How did it work with the space shuttle? Like because I know the wings were sort of all in the back, and like how did it work versus like a conventional like Cessna or jet airliner with the control surfaces?
Okay, what we had during aerodynamic flight, subsonic, which is what Enterprise flew in that regime, we had elevons which worked up and down in unison or alternately left, right for roll. We did have a rudder assembly that actually was a help directionally. We had a body flap, which is more used like for trim, and we had a speed brake, obviously. That's the rudder split in the back to form a speed brake. Now, truthfully, the elevons were bigger. If you were just going to build a subsonic vehicle, the elevons were bigger than they needed to be. They were built for really the max Q point, probably about out at Mach 8 to Mach 3, somewhere in there. So they were built to handle the control muscle, if you will, in that regime. In fact, it's a very complex control system for the entry of shuttle, much more than Apollo. Apollo and Mercury, Gemini, and now Orion, they're capsules. And if you're smart enough to get the blunt in first, they're going to be stable when they hit the air. So all you're controlling is roll, which with an offset center of gravity in the vehicle steals a part of drag to thus give you lift effectively to either move your path left, right, or up or down range. Whereas the shuttle goes through about three different control systems on the way down. Way up when they start into the air, they're using primarily the RCS thrusters for attitude control. They use the body flap somewhat, and they also start using the elevons for yaw control, but in reverse, because adverse yaw is the highest component if you start splitting the elevon motion. So it ends up, in other words, if you move the stick, the elevons go the opposite way of the way they normally go. And then when you get deeper into the regime, and for instance, the rudder is not even activated. The rudder's not in the airstream at such an angle of attack. So it's not activated, I think, to about Mach 8 or 5, somewhere in there. So that's the first time the rudder activates. And from there on, you're kind of like a normal airplane for the use of those controls, elevons, body flap, speed brake.
Thank you.
Semper Fi, and my name is Joe Bowen. I'm a retired airline pilot, and I've listened to about 10 hours of the flight director loop of your accident. And over my 32-year career, I had a few emergencies that I'll just admit that caused my adrenal gland to work really good. And kind of like now, talking in front of these kids. So shortly after the explosion, you said, if I get it right, there was a pretty loud bang associated with that master and caution there. And ever since I heard that, I just want to ask you, did you get a surge of adrenaline at that moment? Or were y'all just really worried about getting things
set? No, I'd say no. I was not fearful in a sense of life-threatening at that time. I got to the instrument panel, and I knew immediately we lost that one tank. It looked like the second tank, tank two, was good. And so I, other tanks, so I thought we were okay, and we'd have just limped home fully powered up with an aborted case. So it became serious as this second tank slowly started leaking. And then the adrenaline flow came up to, because we got pushed into a big hurry to get the lunar module powered up long before we had planned to power it up. And we kind of ad-libbed the power-up checklist. Jim Lovell and I went to the LEM, and basically, as I was going through the activation checklist, I was X-ing out using a Pentel pen and X-ing out segments of the checklist that I knew things we wouldn't even use, like UHF, VHF, COM, communication. That was for just rendezvous. Landing radars, rendezvous radars. I did just X through those system activations. So we were able to do a very hurried power up of the lunar module that way, to have it to use, to live off of, life support, and communication with the ground, attitude control, those things that the LEM could provide.
Yeah, could you describe some of the unique characteristics of flying the LEM, and also at what point during your training program did you feel that you'd mastered that craft?
I'm sorry, first question was, what was it like flying the LEM?
Yes, what were some of the unique, I guess, feel for that craft?
Well, there was, unfortunately, we didn't get to fly it in the normal way people that landed did, where you'd end up with a descent stage, and then just an ascent stage alone. It had no adaptive control system, so you were stuck with the same 100-pound attitude thrusters. And it would have been nicer to have them smaller when you got to the ascent stage, because the LEM started out at 37-something thousand pounds with the descent stage, so it's kind of like a little sluggish even. You call it more like a transport vehicle. When you launched off the moon and pretty much emptied the big tanks for the rocket engine to get to orbit, the rendezvous, now it was a spiffy little fighter. But you had those same little 100-pounders. So it really was, you would like to have had those maybe at 25 pounds at that point. So it was quite a different vehicle over its normal mission flight regime in that respect. What was the second question? Oh, you're talking about the manual burns? Yeah, we did two burn. Movie showed one. We did two maneuvers, burns actually, using one case the descent engine, the engine that would land us on the moon, and the other burn we did was using four jet downward firing those 100-pounders. So in essence, 400 pounds of thrust to make velocity changes in a certain pointing direction to change the trajectory, because it appeared as we're coming back, we kept getting shallower, and they wanted to correct the path. And so we did two of those manually. We didn't have a computer up. So it was done by a sort of a strange alignment. Jim Lovell looked through the front window on his side with the COAS up. This is a little optical sight, like you do in rendezvous, using rendezvous for pointing. and he would point, he'd lay it on the cusp of the earth. It was like a half earth, and he'd lay it on the cusp, and then start a slow pitch up, and I would look through the LEM OAT, the optical telescope, which the upper part of that field of view, that was for shooting stars on the lunar surface where you could get an alignment. But the upper range of that view was 60 degrees up. So when I saw the sun come into the first part of that view, I told Jim to stop. And he stopped the pitch rate. Then we did we could do one entry into the little abort guidance system, which we powered up for those burns. That was called the body axis align. And one entry of 400 plus one, I think it was, into that DETA, gave us needles like ILS needles on the eight ball. And if you held those needles centered, you were holding that attitude. So that's what we used for those maneuvers. And we did not move very much in either of those maneuvers. I mean, the movie made a big deal out of it with the earth going up and down in the window, like we're going to lose control. We didn't move but a degree or two in any axis for those two manual maneuvers.
There. Thank you for speaking at our university tonight. Looking back at your career, how much would you say that you had planned on everything happening? Like your career moves, did you plan everything out, or did it just kind of happen?
I'm sorry, I missed the point of the question again. although I have to say my frequency range, particularly in a higher frequency, is failing. So can somebody repeat what the question was?
She wanted to know, and during your career, how much of your career moves were planned versus just occurring by circumstance?
During my career?
Yeah, during your career, how many of the moves through your stages of your career were planned versus just being a matter of circumstance?
I don't get the point of the question. I'm sorry.
Did you plan out the trajectory of everything you did, or did it just happen as you went along as you made your moves?
Oh, my career path?
Yes.
No, not none of that was very instant, except obviously I joined the military at the point to go into the Naval Aviation Cadet program. But no, most of that was pre-thought with a plan of what, you know, when I left NASA, I interviewed with a number of companies that were building airplanes before I chose NACA. At the time to join when I was leaving school. And so no, none of it was just all in one day. Even my thought about going to the military wasn't settled in, you know, just an instant. It was all done with some thought and what was required, what credentials I need, what my resume would have to be. So all those kind of things were all considerations as I moved through life into different roles and different jobs.
What made you want to go to the moon?
What was that? Say again.
What made you want to go to the moon?
I didn't particularly want to go to the moon. I mean, I didn't have an urgent desire to, when I was growing up or along the way, even think. To me, the Apollo program and the mission to go and land on the moon and do some walking around and collect the geology sample for geology, some samples, was just another great adventure for me. It was just another great adventure, like some of the test programs I had that I went into. So no, I'm not a scientist, so I didn't have the same fervor in that sense of going to the moon as a Jack Schmidt had, who was the only geologist that flew Apollo, probably had about deep in his heart being a PhD geologist about going to the moon. Or a scientist that studies cosmology would have, you know, felt entirely different about it than I did. And I could say the same for Mars. I personally have no interest in going to Mars just to go to Mars, but it'd be another great adventure, certainly.
What was the largest obstacle that you personally faced during your Apollo mission, and how did you overcome it?
The biggest obstacle, and you're talking about Apollo 13?
Correct.
I'm trying to think what would be the biggest obstacle. The biggest concern I had was the activation of the command module. It was a vehicle that had never been planned to be shut down in flight. We had no procedure on board how to power it up. And people on the ground had to spend several days to invent that. And other astronauts tried it out in simulators, redlined it, sent it back, and they worked it back and forth with the system people to perfect it. And I was worried about having to execute this procedure, particularly because we got pushed late to do it. We got the procedure up to us that Jack Schweigert wrote down, and we had no blank paper, incidentally. He had to rip the backs off of checklist books and write on there and carefully number the pages for the procedure, which is very lengthy. And we got to study it. Jack and I were going to do that activation while Jim stayed in the lunar module to maintain attitude, communication, et cetera. And Jack and I leafed through it and talked about the flow of the system, various systems being activated and the steps. And then we went to the command module. I don't remember how many hours ahead, but they were only going to let us start the activation, to start into it, 2.5 hours before entry. 2.5 hours before we're going to hit the air at 25,000 miles an hour. And we're sitting in this dead, dark, wet vehicle that had been dead for 4 days. We had to get towels out to wipe off the instrument panel, to see the instruments. There's so much water. And so that was concerning, because if you knew you're going to do that kind of thing, we'd have been in the simulator and gone through it, dozens of times to get proficiency. And I worried about it a lot. Well, first of all, was the procedure absolutely correct, and that had been no unexplained caution lights or warning lights come on at the wrong time or whatever. And so anyway, it worked out. We went through that. It turned out, and everything, as you saw from the fact I'm here, worked out fine. It came to life. And in fact, it gave us a tie for the second most accurate splashdown of the program. And all flown automatic with the computer. Now, Jack was set to take over manual if he had to, but the computer flew it all the way to splashdown. And it was the second most accurate of the program. After abusing that vehicle, violating specifications on certainly every piece of electronics in the vehicle, freezing it for 4 days. So it's kind of a miracle within the bigger miracle, I guess.
Okay, so this might be a little bit different. When you were done, you splashed down, and you saw your wife, what was the first thing she said to you?
Well, first of all, I didn't call my wife. But the first time we got to see our families and our wives was in Hawaii. We splashed down a helicopter, as you've seen in the footage, picked us up, brought us on board to Iwo Jima. And the next morning, we helicoptered into the Samoan Islands, where an Air Force C-141 was waiting. We had some ceremonial there with whoever the governor or whoever was head of the Samoan Islands. And then whisk off in the C-141 to Hawaii. And President Nixon had stopped by Houston and given an award to Mission Control and picked up our wives, two wives. The Jack Schweigert wasn't married. He was a bachelor, never did marry. And Jim and I, my wife, flew out with President Nixon to Hawaii. So that's the first time I got to see my wife. I don't think she, what you're getting at is maybe why in the heck did you fly that mission? There wasn't any of that because she'd been with me through my days as a test pilot. And we had problems and accidents and test pilots got hurt. So the profession I was in was had that possibility. So it wasn't like this mission was something new in that respect, if that's what you were talking about.
Hello, Mr. Fred Hayes. My name is Dante Holmquist, and I would like to know what an average day of training for Apollo 13 would be like.
I'm sorry, you'd like to know what something for Apollo 13 would feel like? What?
What is your average person, in your personal experience, what is the average day of Apollo 13 training like?
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. We basically spent training, and the major part of the training was in three directions. One, we spent a lot of time in simulators, which could replicate the spacecraft. The same geometry you laid on the couch. Now, we cheated since we didn't wear spacesuits most of the time and had a pad we laid on the couches. But the instrument panel, all the systems functioned operationally. We even had visuals out windows, not very good visuals in those days, but visuals like a look at Earth horizon, that kind of thing. And they also could put failures in, over 500 failures they could put into the simulation for the command module and about 300 for the lunar module. So we did a lot of training with mission control with a special group that devised failures they would impart at their designated times to make us look bad. That was their goal in life, was to make us and our mission control look bad. And so we went several thousand hours of those kind of simulations. The other training we spent a lot of time at was out in the field somewhere doing geology training. Out in, you know, wherever the, whatever the subject was, like we went to Sudbury, Canada to look at the fracture cones where a big meteorite had hit there. And now that's a benefit, they got silver mines and I think copper mines there in Canada. So we went to places that offered a special lesson of some sort. And I did, all total counting, four missions I cycled through, I did 31 of those geology field trips. So they were wherever they were. I mean, they were in Germany, several in Hawaii, all over the U.S., predominantly the southwestern U.S., where the outcrops are exposed. You got to see the rocks to study them. So that was another form of training. And the other was we did still flight training. We had T-38 aircraft, so we did some flight training to keep our skills up that way, just from handling a real flying machine. And for the commanders, they flew this training vehicle, the LLRV, a research vehicle, later called the LLRF. And it was like a bedstead that had a jet engine and had hydrogen peroxide jets for attitude control. And we crashed three of those. When we finished the program, we only had two left. I didn't get to fly it till I was a backup commander in 16, and I flew 22 flights on the LLTV. So, and it was something that got your adrenaline up every time, because you're always a little short of gas to get it down on the ground. So that's about it. But you lived by a schedule that was published weekly of what you would do every day. There were a lot of meetings with scientists about some of the science objectives and about the experiments you're going to do while you're on the moon, for instance, the ALSEP package. So we had a tremendous amount of meetings. It was very busy days on 8 and 11. The last month was literally 7 days a week, and often from 8 in the morning until like 9 or 10 at night, every day, 7 days a week. Because you had so much got stacked in there that you still had to get through to get ready for that launch that was coming no matter whether you're ready or not. So you got pushed into that kind of a schedule. All of them were like that, even the stretch ones, last month. Okay, one more question. Lots of luck, yeah.
Hello. I guess I'm going to be asking the last question. Okay, so my question is, while you were sleeping on that mission, do you remember if you had any dreams?
So what was the question? All right.
Did you say what was the question? Okay, I'll ask the question again. The question was, while you were sleeping on the mission, did you have any dreams?
Oh, did I have dreams while sleeping?
Yes.
Well, I didn't sleep very much. With the temperature, whereas it got down in the 30s Fahrenheit, I put on extra underwear. I had two extra sets of underwear I put on. Unfortunately, they were cotton and not thermal. And that outer garment we had was Teflon coated over the beta cloth to keep it from fraying. And it almost assumed the temperature of the air, which got down in, I'd say, the high 30s in the limb. So it was very cold. So we mostly took cat naps. I developed a urinary tract infection that gave me chills and fever about the last day and a half before entry. So I'd feel pretty lousy when I had the shivers, and then ultimately the fever actually, it was an improvement in making you feel warm. But.
Okay. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Just a good round of applause for Mr. Fred Hayes.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.